Morning, everyone. Thank you to the organisers and thank you to Paul for inviting me here. I was thinking about something like the take-home messages. I know it's probably a bit early. One of the tricks, or not really a trick, but I do quite a lot of interviewing in my role at the Welcome, and one of the sort of, the tricks I sort of tend to ask people, just typically as they're leaving the interview, which is a little bit cruel, I suspect, is, okay, I've got a short memory. What are the three things I should remember you by? And I think the three things I remember this conference by are, one, this sort of great concern about data, and perhaps the funders like the Welcome should perhaps consider recommending that our data, which is produced under Welcome funding, should be, well, I was going to say the word license, but it's not a license, of course, but should be should be linked under the CC0 license waiver. I'll get it right eventually. So that's one take-home message. Secondly, I was really pleased to hear that a real recognition that if an OA fee is paid, it should be full open access, and that's one of the things the Welcome Trust and I have spent many, many years banging that drum, that if we pay a fee, we want more than just to be able to read the content. And thirdly, perhaps slightly more facetiously, anyone offers you a herb-infused snap, then avoid it at all costs. It is as foul as it sounds. But thank you to Martin for introducing me to that experience. Okay, so I'm going to try and talk reasonably briefly this morning because I think a lot of this is going to be very familiar to you. I'll try and show you some new things. But what I was going to just recap really, really quickly, because I'm sure we're all bored sick of it, is the policy, how you comply with it. I was going to spend a bit of time thinking about the author pays model. It may not be the only model out there, but certainly in the area the trust is focused on, it's a very, very predominant model. Talk about compliance. I'll give you some data about the compliance levels the Welcome Trust enjoys. I think that's the wrong word, but you'll see I show you that data. And what we need to do to actually realise the goals of open access. I'm sure you know about the Welcome Trust, but we're an independent charity. We're in the UK. We fund medical research. We spend about 650 million sterling a year. And I can't remember now whether we're the biggest or whether the Gates Foundation is the biggest, but we're one of the top two anyway. So we're a fairly large player. I work in the library, so if you're ever in London, pop into the library, which is in the new Welcome Collection building. So that's the trust. And the policy which we've had, we introduced a policy back in 2005 for new grant holders, and then for anyone who's got funding from us from 2006. And it's very, very simple. There are no exceptions. If you take Welcome Trust money, a condition of grant, which preempts any publisher arrangement, the condition of grant says you've got to make the research available as soon as possible. And then there's a sort of, in a worst case scenario, within 6 months of publication. And we specify the repository. And there are two principal ways which we do that. Our preferred route is the authors publishing an open access journal, you know, the sort which this society, this organisation promotes, or a hybrid journal. But we have like a fallback position. There are certain publishers which don't offer an open access option. So in those cases, we say to the author, you have to self-archive. If, in an unlikely event, a publisher doesn't offer either of those, then we encourage the author to change the license arrangements or look for another publisher. So let's go on to how we meet these costs. Something we've said from day one, and really the director of the trust, Mark Wolpert, has been one of the leading lights in this. You know, and I think Welcome Trust have punched above their weight in this debate. But we've always said that publication costs are just legitimate research costs. There's no point in spending millions of pounds on a case control consortium study, and it is millions of pounds, to then worry about where you're going to find that $3,000 to ensure that everyone can read that research. So we've always said they're just research costs, just as buying mice or buying beakers or whatever. They're just costs. And the back of the envelope figure we calculated some time ago suggested that if we met the cost of all open access publications which were attributed to the Wellcome Trust, it would be around about 1-2% of our research spend. And that figure does seem to be remarkably accurate at the moment. We're not spending 1% at the moment, but you'll see why when I show you the compliance figures. But I think if we get 100% compliance, it will be somewhere between that 1-2%. And we're two ways in which our grant holders can get hold of our funds. For the top 30 institutions in the UK, and top 30 in the sense that they receive most Wellcome funding, we give them a block grant at the start of the year, in which they can draw down on to pay open access publisher fees. If you're an institution outside that top 30, we just supplement your grant. So this is additional funds to meet these costs. So it's a bit of a cliche again, but we actually do believe the publisher adds value to the research process. We think there is value in validating research and stamping it and so forth with their brand and so forth. If we didn't want to do that, we could just say just stick a preprint up on the Wellcome website. But we don't. We actually believe the publisher adds value. But as something we've said for time immemorial almost, we will only meet these costs when we get full or what Peter Suber called Libra open access. So when it's absolutely clear that the license attached to this to these articles can be reused, they can be translated, they can be text and data mined, and so forth. One of the things we potentially conceded early on was a recognition that publishers can retain the exclusive commercial rights on these articles. And a lot of people come up to me and say, well, why do you allow that? Why, you know, if they're getting money from you for the open access cost, doesn't that, you know, negate the need to try and, you know, have exclusive commercial use? And I think it comes back to this sort of discussion we had on Monday about, you know, pragmatism versus dogmatism. And yeah, we could have stuck out for that, but quite frankly, we felt that was that fight really wasn't worth taking on. And conceding that early on brought a huge number of publishers in who were concerned that they wanted the exclusive right to go and try and sell reprints and so forth. So we have no problem with that, but I recognise that, you know, for the purists, we may have conceded early on. So what's the uptake like of this? You typically hear this sort of figure of, you know, 1%, less than 1%, but I think there is some evidence which suggests that the author pays model is, perhaps albeit slowly, is being taken up by the research community. And I thank OUP here for supplying me with this data. But across all the OUP Oxford Open titles, I can't remember how many there are at the moment, but whatever that number is, it's about 6% of all articles in those journals are being now routed through the Oxford Open programme. And this data does exclude NAR, which would sway it somewhat. And even across STM, so it's 5.8% across all Oxford Open titles. Within the STM ones, it's 5.96%. And there are some real big players amongst that, and Bioinformatics is, we're now up to basically a third of all articles in that journal are going through this OA route, the Oxford Open route. And I wonder, are we at that, when it gets to 30%, is that the tipping point? Does the publisher say, okay, this is full open access now, you know, it's author pays? And we're spending real money. This year we're going to spend well over £1.5 million on author pays fees. So, you know, money is leaving the Wellcome Trust, it's going somewhere. So I think there's evidence that this model is being used. And then, of course, the other question is, well, aren't we paying twice? Aren't we paying subscriptions and author fees? And of course, yes, of course we are. I mean, we know that. We're not quite that naive. You could argue, though, is this anything new? You know, haven't we always paid page charges, colour plates and so forth? So perhaps there's nothing new there. But I think what evidence there is, and I think it is pretty scant at the moment, but what evidence there is does seem to suggest that subscription costs are sensitive to open access payments. And I think the caveat really is there is too little data to be absolutely certain of this. But the investment BNP Paribas recently did a brief analysis which showed that Elsevier cut its prices in the nuclear physics journals by 20%, where typically the price increase across Elsevier was an increase of 5%. And again, Oxford Journals, again, they're the good guys here because they do make they put their data in the public domain. So we can see that for this year, for 2010 actually, the average journal price increase across their stable of titles was 6.7. But for those in the Oxford Open program, it was a smaller rate, and that was a repeat of the previous years. So I think there is some evidence that subscriptions are falling as open access articles take precedence. And of course, this was discussed by Bramwyn on Monday, but it does seem to be, and I apologise if this is again being very bureaucratic and looking at the process and so forth, but it does look as if the author pays model and open access publishing may be a way of reducing total costs. And I think, you know, even Wellcome Trust with its, we have £12 billion, our asset base is about 10 or 12 billion, I don't know, it's a huge amount. But we're still obviously looking for ways in which we can, you know, maximise that and reduce costs where possible. So there have been two independent studies, and I'll be honest, I don't understand all the macroeconomics in either of these studies, but both of them conclude that flipping to the, moving away from subscriptions to the open access model saves money. So I think, you know, that the evidence is beginning to be pretty conclusive. But we're not there by any stretch of imagination, so there are a number of issues we still need to resolve, and I'll just quickly work through some of them. So first of all, I'll show you our compliance figures. I like the graph because it's clearly going in one trajectory. So this shows since November 06 through to January 09, we leave at least a 6-month gap before we do the analysis to allow for the 6-month embargo for those author manuscripts. And we're now seeing that over a third of articles are appearing in our repository within 6 months of publication. And that, as you can see, is a clear improvement from back in 2006 when it was probably less than 15%. 36% though is still, in my opinion, pretty disappointing after 3 years of promoting this, 3 years of talking to authors and publishers. So there's still clear evidence we need to do a lot more. I think a slightly, this is typical spin here, a much more pleasing figure is the fact that when we look at where our authors publish, the overwhelming majority, 95% of these journals which are used by Wellcome authors have a fully Wellcome Trust compliant publishing option. And one of the concerns we had early on was, is our policy going to restrict where our authors can publish? And that those figures show that clearly isn't the case. Authors can still seek to publish in a journal of their choice. And anyone can do this search. Well, it's very, very crude. We go into PubMed, we find Wellcome Trust papers, and we say, are they in PubMed Central? Very simple. Anyone can replicate this. And I haven't got a graph to show you, but I also did very crude, and I wouldn't really put my life on this, but I looked on Friday at the number of papers which emanate from the Wellcome Trust Sanger Institute. So the Wellcome Trust Sanger Institute is really part of the Wellcome Trust family. And they also, obviously, they're covered by our mandate, but they also have an institutional mandate which mirrors our mandate. And I say the numbers are relatively small, but when I did a search on Friday, I replicated this search, so I was looking at particularly articles published between 1st and 31st of January 2009, so it's quite a small cohort. But in that cohort, 80% of articles were in PubMed Central. So I think that shows that when you get buy-in, you know, from an institution, then you really do start to see compliance increase. What's being deposited? Again, a very, very simple analysis. Is this just the author manuscript, or is it the publisher deposition? And you can see from Wellcome's perspective, the publisher deposition is the way articles get into PubMed Central. We know that authors are pretty poor at depositing content, which is really, apart from all the other reasons of reuse and so forth, that's one of the real reasons why we like the route A, the publisher deposition route, because publishers do it and authors don't always. And you can see that only 15-16% of papers in PubMed Central from Wellcome are from the author manuscript route. But what we're going to do to get this from 35-36% to sort of the dizzying heights of 80%, I think 80% will be when I think it's job done. I mean, perhaps it should be 100%, but 80%, 90%, I'll be happy with it. So the problem in part is authors not self-archiving. And we're trying to mitigate this by obviously raising awareness and trying to articulate the consequences of non-compliance. That's sort of the most threatening language without being too threatening. So what we did, just around about Christmas time, the director of the trust sent a letter to all vice chancellors in the UK where we expressed disappointment with our compliance and stated that we were going to start monitoring this more closely to check on compliance. And it's evident that just that letter on its own has had some effect, that we've seen like a 52% increase in the number of manuscripts added to PubMed Central within the first 6 months compared with the previous 6 months last year. So that helps. And following on from that, what we're now doing is researchers, they have to send an end-of-grant report form to us detailing their outputs. And we're looking through that report, and it's a fairly manual process at the moment, checking to see if they're in UK PubMed Central. Where they're not, we go back to the author and say, you just be aware that you're now in breach of grant conditions. Can you take action to get these articles into PubMed Central? So I haven't got any data yet on the effect of that. So what we haven't done at the moment is explicitly say, and we stop funding you. That sort of what I call the nuclear option is there for later. So I think part of the problem is authors, they're not doing their stuff. I think also we have to fess up here that publishers don't always have the workflows in place to support the deposition of papers into PubMed Central. And we've worked hard with Elsevier. Elsevier represent about 25% of all Wellcome, about 25% of all Wellcome papers are published in an Elsevier journal of one kind or another. So we work quite close to them to make sure that there is a nice, easy workflow by which authors who publish in Elsevier can comply with our mandate. And Elsevier simply modified their workflow such that when an author is successful and that paper's now been accepted, the author goes back onto the system and the system says, then, did this paper arise from any funding? You know, which of these? And you click on the radio button, Welcome Trust, and you're sort of routed to a separate part of the workflow. Soft music comes on, and it'll sort of, anyway, it's made quite easy for you, for the author to check the relevant box to say, okay, yes, I'm happy to for this to go into PubMed Central, and yes, I will pay the $3,000 because Welcome Trust will reimburse me. So we need other publishers to particularly the hybrid ones to introduce workflows like that. But I think it's also incumbent, we have to say that as funders, we haven't probably demonstrated the benefits of open access to our researchers. And that's something we're trying to address through UKPMC. So it's a couple of screenshots, which are probably can't read from there. And I was going to try and get a new one last night because there's no internet. So we introduced this function called grant reporting, in which our researchers can log on, they can link all their papers, whether they're in PubMed or whether they're in UKPMC, and they can link them to their specific grants, and then they can get an output, they can produce a page which lists all their outputs or outputs per specific grant. At the moment we've linked it with Web of Science data. We've also got, I hope we get a new shop, because we've also got Scopus data. So the user can see how many times their article has been cited, and we're going to introduce download data to this report as well. So just trying to give them something back, give the researcher something back. And we're going to early in the new year we're relaunching UKPMC, and it will have various sort of features to try and distinguish it from PMC in the States. So it's one way we're working with EBI. And NACTEM, the Text Mining Centre in the UK, to highlight biological entities from an article, and to do more curated. The first bit is purely programmatic. It's looking for words and comparing them with a dictionary. And then secondly, we are a more curated search to find relevant proteins and protein interactions in the full text. So what other things need to be done? Well, I think funders also need to clarify how these open access payments can be made. And one of the things we're doing actually next week is we're running a workshop for administrators in the UK, where all the UK PMC funders will try and articulate again how, if you're funded, if your research is funded by the MRC, how the open access costs can be met, and so forth. We're also encouraging institutions to establish open access central funds, open access budgets, and Stephen, after the break, will no doubt talk more about that. And as I've already alluded to, we're looking for publishers to improve workflows. But also, I mean, is the single price mechanism, though it's easy to understand, I can quote, all Elsevier journals are either $3,000, or they're Cellcraft and they're $5,000, or they're Lancet and it's £450 a page or something. But three costs for 1,800 journals or so. Is that really, though it's nice and easy to remember, and perhaps we need simplicity, but is that really the best way to do it? Are there some journals which should be a lot cheaper, because the rejection rate and so forth is much less, and some journals need to be more expensive? I don't know, but is the one-size-fits-all the best way to go? I think we also need to a strong commitment that there is a clear recognition, a clear connection between the number of author pays manuscripts and the subscription cost. I'd also add to this, I don't know, I haven't got it on this slide actually, but whether or not there's any mileage in introducing submission fees. So, you introduce a submission fee, and whether your article gets accepted publication or not, you pay that submission fee, and that separates the submission fee, the managing the peer review process and so forth, from the publication fee. So I don't know. I mean, no publishers seem to be wanting to try and take that on at the moment, for obvious reasons that if they're the first, that may disadvantage authors from seeking publication there. I think still there's a bewildering array of publisher policies out there. I won't go through all this, but virtually every possible permutation you can think of, from through to no fee, no embargo, through to self-archiving but not welcome, trust compliant, it's all there. The only one I can't find at the moment, I crossed this out last night, was I can't think of any publisher who offers an author pays model now which isn't welcome compliant. British Journal of Cancer recently, they moved from using a no derivatives license, which was never going to be acceptable to us, to a share-alike license, which is. So it's, that's good. But there's still for the busy researcher trying to understand the nuances between some of these policies is beyond them. It's just not interested. It's sort of move on. And I think the other thing is clear. We really do need to work out how we are going to flip the model. If as these studies are showing, that savings can be made, moving to open access, and not only just financial savings, but the opportunity costs of ensuring that all research is available. We need to do that. So I think we need to model transition scenarios, and Salvatore is going to talk about the Scope 3 project. There are licensing arrangements, the Max Planck with Springer, for example. There's talk in the UK about whether there's value in some like a NESLE 2 type arrangement for administering open access fees. So I think there's a number of things we can start to look at. I think we also need to look at all the costs in the chain, and can they be reduced? Do we need print now? Can we just bite the bullet and say let's move to e-only? This is my point about the submission fee. So if we introduce that, then we get the true cost of publication versus the true cost of administering the actual peer review part of the process. And is there, I'm not saying this is something the Wellcome Trust is pushing, but is there a move that we move to slightly a lighter touch? So the plus one model, whereby as long as it's scientifically valid, it's published, it doesn't matter whether it's relevant to that particular journal, as it were. So is there a need to move to that sort of model? And so what we're trying to do is work with in the UK, the Research Information Network. I'm on their scholarly communications group, and it has representatives from publishers as well as funders and librarians. And we're literally the work, I believe, starts Monday, and we're just trying to work out what, you know, what does it mean to flip the model. So finally, I think from Wellcome Trust perspective, the policy has been there for a long time. The infrastructure is in place. I will say in passing that we are, in my sort of expansionist role here, we are looking to, the ambition is to transform UK PMC into a Europe-wide PubMed Central. As our first step along that, we are working with four European, like non-UK funders, who are going to come on board in the next, this quarter, this autumn. And we're providing them with a repository service, so researchers funded by these institutions can put their papers there. And then we're going to look to work with, obviously, the big players in Europe, DFG, and CERN, and so forth, to see whether or not there is an appetite to create a, you know, a single life sciences repository. We need to build on these developments, and obviously we need to improve compliance still, and obviously we're monitoring that very closely, develop better mechanisms to meet these author side payments, and the key one really is developing these transition models. And then I think, you know, hopefully I won't be standing here in 5 years' time saying the same thing again. 5 years' time, I hope I can say, and we've now achieved this. Anyway, so I've used up my half hour, so thank you very much for your attention.
Hi, Ethan Ruskin at PubMed Central. I was a bit surprised to hear that it seems that in terms of enforcement there's a strongly worded letter, but why do you think there is this lack of compliance with the policy, which I don't know, it sounds like it should be mandatory, but people seem to be ignoring it.
Well, it is mandatory. There isn't a choice. There is no sort of get out of jail free card. I think it's for those reasons I try to allude to. I think there is still confusion out there. I don't think researchers see it as their number one priority, partly because we haven't demonstrated the real benefits of doing this, and it's too complicated. So, you know, I don't think it just doesn't get done. I mean, I think we are, I don't know any other funder which is publicly, you know, publishing its compliance data, so I don't know whether our 36% is good, bad, or indifferent. Personally, I think it's disappointing. Obviously, the ultimate sanction is we will, you know, that will have to be linked to funding.
Has that ever happened?
It hasn't happened yet. I mean, there are probably quite good practical reasons why that has not. We, you know, simply administratively, there is a process in place. That universe is expecting those funds. There are people employed and so forth. So to stop, turn off the tap would possibly be, without an awful lot of discussion beforehand, may just seem too aggressive and too, perhaps, disproportionate. But it is an option we can revert to, but it has been more... more on persuasion and less on punitive actions at the moment.
Robert, I was just wondering whether maybe part of the problem is that the deposition process will be probably driven by the corresponding author.
Yep.
And so, a lot, you know, as you pointed out before, a lot of these papers will have multiple funders, and so if the corresponding, you know, so if the Wellcome Trust funding, say, is associated with a co-author, you know, a fifth author on the paper or something, could, you know, it just might be that practically it's difficult for that connection then to be made. The corresponding author might not kind of get it, but because one of their co-authors is Wellcome Trust funded, but, you know, that might not then drive the process or something.
I think that certainly is the case, which is, again, why we're working with the whole UK PMC funders group, because typically if research is funded by the Wellcome, there is another funder on there. I think our figures suggest that 80% of Wellcome Trust attributed research has another funder attached to it. But typically that will be one of the other funders in the UK PMC funders group. We all have the same policy. So we just need to ensure that, you know, Wellcome may be the fifth author, MRC first, BBSRC second. We've all got the same policy. We just need to promote that. And we certainly, the Wellcome Trust accepts that in the short term, we will probably pick up the OA costs for that, because it's easier for a researcher to get money from the Wellcome than perhaps it is from other funders. But I think that is a point, so we need to make it clear that, you know, if you are a Wellcome author on a joint fund, you know, a paper with other people, you should be trying to encourage the lead author to be aware of that, but also the lead author needs to be aware that their funders also require identical requirements.
This is more a comment. In my field, which is information systems, there's a body of literature about the adoption of IT systems. Why do people voluntarily take into use systems like Facebook and so forth? And quite clear explanations to if the system is not absolutely mandatory, you have to take it into use. What are the factors that affect taking it into use? And I think one of the key questions in all of the uptake of repository copies, and in your case, is that especially younger researchers, they respond best to pressure from their senior professors and others, those who are the opinion leaders. They're the guys who tell them in which journal should be published to get tenure. If these senior colleagues tell them you have to put up a copy in the repository, or if they tell them that, or even better, if they put up their stuff there. So if you want to influence scientists broadly about the position, it's the best way to do is to go to the top leading scientists and by example others will follow.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, J.P. van Niekerk from South Africa. She was a panelist of a very welcome development. My concern is with emerging journals from, for instance, Africa, where this model would in fact increase the gulf between the international journals and local journals which are aspiring to get places, and this would leave them completely in the cold. Could you perhaps respond to that?
Yes, I can see the point you're making, and yes, it is a risk. But if these journals in Africa, presumably they will also benefit from being open access, though, in terms of, you know, hopefully they'll be used more. So it may be a quid pro quo. But we heard from Peter that an awful lot of open access journals, you know, don't charge an open access fee. I confess this, I'm focusing really on where Wellcome authors typically publish, and obviously in the main it is in well-established Western journals. But I don't know if anyone else wants to try and answer that from a developing world perspective. Mm. But I accept it is a potential problem that we just exacerbate the gulf. But those researchers will have problems accessing some of this research already. It won't all be available through Hinari-like initiatives. I don't even know if South Africa would, for example, would count. Does South Africa enjoy Hinari? Or is South Africa outside of Hinari?
Outside.
So you already are disadvantaged. You can't get to a lot of this content. So open access is one way in which researchers in that community would be able to get to this content.
Ours is open access. I'm concerned about emerging.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I see actually a few hands, but I think we need to move on. So hopefully during the coffee break, we can speak with Robert.
Absolutely.
And thank you once again.
Thank you.
It's been very nice. You got a book?
Oh, okay, good. Excellent. I'm a librarian. Lovely.
Right,
Thanks
thank
very
you
much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.